and we haven't had to fund that berm, but the reality is it's unsustainable for any of us to be able to continue to basically have the government pure, you know, just on its own, shoulder this burden. And so, and this started happening before President Obama implemented the legislation. There's people in Washington, at Health and Human Services area, the Office of Management and Budget, and the Healthcare Secretary, and the Federal Actuary that is looking at all of this information and knows this information about the trajectory of spend. And if you think about that, he's looking at the rate of spending on Medicare pre-baby boom generation retirement, okay? And then you double the population, and then we know that the prevalence of chronic disease, because we're not getting any healthier, we're actually increasing the numbers of chronic diseases that we each have as individuals. So the average chronic disease prevalence in a senior, I think it's over, each senior has more than three chronic disease conditions. You know, diabetes, heart disease, this, that, and the other thing. So you add them up, and that prevalence is just increasing exponentially the burden on the system. Okay, so it's really, the math of this doesn't work in the sense that you can't sustain this. And if we just let the math exercise work, over 50% of our economy within like 25, 30 years would be consumed by healthcare. Now, if we allow 50% of our economy to be consumed by healthcare, what's going to happen to education? What's going to happen to, you know, roads and, you know, nothing else works. And we should basically not be spending more than maybe 8 to 10 cents on the dollar on healthcare. Now, we could sustain ourselves with, and we are today, with 20% of the healthcare cost, you know, that making up 20% of our federal budget, or 20% of our hospital budget. But the challenge is that basically, unless we get in front of this and we get to the underlying issues, we're not going to really be able to fix the system. And so, and you don't hear any of the candidates talking about any of that yet. It's surprising to me because it's known by all the experts. And so people just don't want, for whatever reason, it's not rocket science either. Some of it's just common sense. So we have to address those issues and these macroeconomic issues. So what was the premise for this Affordable Care Act thing? Okay. I should say I commend our president and the administration, and I will also tell you, I am a Republican. And there's things that I only say that because I am, and it's good to know, we are a product of our environments and how we grew up and the environment in which we grew up. And there's no denying who we are and where we came from, okay? But I don't think that these concepts are mutually exclusive. I think you can be a fiscal conservative, which I consider to be a Republican ideal, maybe more so. It's not necessarily a party thing, but you can be a fiscal conservative with a social conscience. And we need to find a way to help people that need help. So you can do both of those things. And I'm not a believer, and many people might be more survival of the fittest, but the reality is we've got one of the wealthiest countries in the world, and we can fix these problems, and we need to address these from a public policy issue perspective and really start to address these things. So when you stand back, and you look at what this president did. He was the first president in six presidents. There were six, or at least five prior to him, that attempted health care reform and failed. And he did all the tricks that you could imagine to get this passed, including with the executive order, all of those things to circumvent this thing. But what he did in this thing, that I have to give him great credit for, is he got the legislation passed. And he got us on the train to start going down this path. And the interesting thing, and part of what makes this so complicated, but also the thing that makes it very interesting, is there isn't any idea, good or bad, that anybody ever came up with that isn't incorporated in this framework legislation. Okay? So, and I will say the framework is pretty sound and durable, and I'll explain when I get into it a little bit what I mean by that. But it is really kind of, I thought when I first read this and I understood what was happening, I thought it was the craziest thing I'd ever seen. Okay? But as I've looked at all of the obstacles and the nature of our democracy in our country, and I love Winston Churchill, and you probably know this quote that he made, and I think this was a quote that was made when the Americans got into the war kind of a little bit later than maybe they should have. That might have avoided some of the casualties of war that occurred. But he said, and I agree with this, Americans always do the right thing, but only after we've exhausted every other option. So and that's a paraphrase, but basically that's exactly what we're doing with this healthcare legislation that we passed. And the thing that I've grown to appreciate is that the conditions that were imposed on the president by the Congress and the states and states' rights activists, because when you step back and look at health insurance and many forms of insurance, it's basically the states and it's a states' rights issue to determine what they need and how to govern their insurance activities. So we have 50 states that have an insurance commissioner and a set of regulations that administer their programs, not just for health, but for property, casualty, life, all of those things that are state controlled, if you will. Okay? So there are constitutionalists, and when this went to the Supreme Court, and there was debate about what should vest in the rights of states and what is really the authority or the ability of the federal government to do any of this. And at the end of the day, the gridlock in Congress and the word that kind of kept coming to the top, particularly by Republicans, but by a lot of folks that were concerned, is no new taxes. Okay? And so whatever this reform was, it wasn't to add to the federal deficit. Okay? So no new taxes. Now, there are 21 or 23 assessments that are layered in this reform bill, because the other thing that was fundamental to this was it can't increase the federal deficit, or add to the federal deficit, and it also has to be self-funding within the industry. Okay? So people promulgated, here's the objectives of this legislation. We have 50 million uninsured people in this country. We want to insure as many of those 50 million uninsured as we can. We want to have equity, we want to have social equity, we want to have tax equity. We need to have a fair system for providing coverage to our population across the country. And so that became part of the mantra of this, to avoid the T word, the tax word, at the federal level. We could have probably, if we would have embraced or adopted something akin to the Medicare program administered in the private sector for the whole country, we would have eliminated a lot of this chaos that we have today. But it wasn't to be, and it would have never happened, at least in the context of what the president and the framers of this legislation were trying to do. So, and the other thing that was interesting, I don't know how many people in here might work in the pharma industry, and I give the pharma industry great credit in the sense that basically the special interest groups in our country are alive and well, and the pharma industry is probably the most prolific within healthcare, and if you look at the industry overall, the pharma industry represents most of the margin in the whole industry, if you look at it at the macro level. And the pharma companies, it was kind of like cutting the deal with the devil. They came to the table first, and they cut a deal that was very favorable to the pharma industry coming into this. And I think the folks that were dealing with them as the most powerful special interest group in the country, in this industry, were saying, we need to get them on the train with everybody else. And so they made these compromises. And the framers of this said, this is a 10-year journey. It's not going to happen overnight. Something needs to happen, and we need to start moving. And so when I stepped back and I realized the context in which this happened, I basically changed my mind as to how good this was in the sense of the framework. Another disparity, a significant disparity, is the states decide, each state decides how much their social benefit network is going to be. And there are some states, Texas, Florida, Georgia, more Georgia and Texas, basically have a belief system that it's survival of the fittest. And we're not going to provide benefits to people that can't take care of themselves in a holistic way. And so they have very pared down and almost non-existent benefits in some of these categories of providing health care and other social service support to their populations based upon their philosophical bent in their states. And in other states, including Pennsylvania, Ohio, and California, had very rich benefits. And we going into this, the overall uninsured rate in our country when this was passed was over 18%. Now Pennsylvania's uninsured rate was about 12.5%. And we had something called CHIP, which was implemented first in Pennsylvania, Cover All Children. So we actually had, of the 11-12% uninsured rate, a third of them were kids. Now they had access to insurance if their parents signed them up. Now there's reasons that parents don't sign their kids up. We don't have to describe them here, but they are, and some of them just don't want to be documented. But there's other reasons too. But the bottom line is that the structural uninsured rate in Pennsylvania was really, you know, about 7-8%. And so if you average this, if you have some states, and Massachusetts was in like low single digits. So if you average this out and you took the uninsured rates in places like Georgia and Texas and other places, probably 30% some. So basically, but the inequity of this legislation is, and what President Obama was trying to do, we need to get those people insured, okay? And the funds to provide that incremental insurance coverage were being provided at the federal level through subsidies. And so if you were in Texas, or Florida, and this is where many, like the Republican governor of Florida says, I'm going to sign on to this because I'm going to get more money from my constituents in Florida than I would if I didn't agree to this. And then we'll wait and see what happens 3 or 4 years if this thing goes a different direction. But if you think about the financial inequity of states like Pennsylvania and Ohio cross-subsidizing states like Texas and Georgia, it doesn't make any economic sense, and they should be paying their fair share for their entire population and not having those of us in these other states disproportionately fund the uninsured because they don't have good comprehensive benefits in their states. And so there's those kinds of issues. We are a country of states, okay? And the objective was to basically provide this comprehensive coverage. And so over time, once you're on this train, and the theory is that 3 to 5 years out, this is all going to be homogenized, and we're going to end up with something that's going to be rational, and we're going to have the coverage for everybody. And so I just accepted the fact that this is just, there's a lot of things in this world that aren't fair. It's just the way it is, and we have to move on and try to. And I think it was Martin Luther King that said that basically the arc of justice is long and bending, but it eventually gets us to where we need to go to. And there's a lot of inequities and injustices getting from here to there, but as long as we're bending towards that, you know, moral justice, then basically we're better off than not doing that. So basically, when you step back and look at this legislation, and we look at this book, what was intended was that for those of us that can afford to fund healthcare costs, there was an expectation in all of this under these market exchanges that basically the federal subsidy is pegged to the Silver Plan level, which from an actuarial perspective, it means that basically if you're buying a Silver Plan level, you're going to have, the expectation is you're going to cover 30% of the cost out of pocket. And you could, as an individual, buy something that's at the bronze level, and you're going to pay less. You'll pay more out of pocket. You pay less on premium, more out of pocket. But the expectation was that, let's just say for a family of four today, it's over $25,000, $26,000, I think, to cover a family of four on average across the country. Okay. So the expectation is that 30% of the cost of that coverage is going to be borne by us as individuals or family members. And it's kind of a way of achieving equity across the board. Now, if we are at a lower income level, we're going to be subsidized, and maybe fully subsidized if we don't have an income. Okay, and so part of the legislation was to expand Medicaid from the 100% of the federal poverty level up to whatever 150% of the federal poverty level, and then for people that are on an exchange up to 400% of the poverty level, there's going to be some subsidy level associated with that. Okay, so basically, the framers are saying that basically there's an expectation in our society that we may have gotten something, you know, that we weren't funding directly before, that's going away. There's no other source of paying for this other than to have each of us share in this in some proportionate way. And because nothing in this life's free. I mean, you know, somebody has to pay it from some source. And so those exchanges are and this methodology that's there, the 25%, 22-25% increase that was just announced last week, that a lot of that's subsidized by people. And a lot of it is dependent upon the local market that these bids were placed in. And there were insurance companies, because they're through the initial implementation of the legislation, there were adjustments that the federal government was going to make insurance companies whole for losses through the implementation. Many of those insurance companies gamed the system, swept the market, thinking that they were basically going to cover all these lives, and they would have those lives, because once you're in a plan, the likelihood you're going to change in the future is less likely. It typically doesn't happen. And then there was an expectation that basically these risk adjustments were going to make them partially, if not fully, whole for those losses. And it didn't happen that way. So there's all of these crazy things that happened in the initial implementation of the plan, some of which has caused these increases in these bid prices, if you will, for the plans that are in the exchanges, that basically are, you know, for those of us that are at the lower income levels, really doesn't have much of an impact to us because of the way the subsidies are working. So, but the bottom line is, and I guess what the point that I want to try to get across is the fact that this is a very high cost operation of providing health care in our country, 20% of our economy, and somebody's going to pay it. And the way the framers approach this, there's an expectation that we as consumers, if we can afford it, are going to pay 30% out of pocket. And that's it. And we might not like it, but we might say, I'm going to go without coverage. And I will tell you that, you know, it's not a good thing to go without coverage. Because, you know, you can get bad credit. I mean, you might not go bankrupt if you don't have assets, but you don't want to have bad, all of those sorts of things. And there's catastrophic protection. And so you have to think twice, you know, about not getting coverage. And if you really can't afford it, then you should have a subsidy, and it should be available to you. So those are issues that people should be sensitive to. Now, people are talking about, can this be repealed, and will it? There'll be modifications, but if you step back and look at how this was implemented, the first thing that was put into the legislation were all the consumer protections. Think about it, you know. And there's 10 essential health benefits with coverage. You know, there's you can't be denied access for pre-existing conditions or lifetime maximums. All that stuff goes away. And you can't be discriminated against based upon your health status. Everybody, there are ranges based upon age demographics that say that people are going to pay some differential based upon a couple of age and other criteria. And if you smoke, you're going to pay a little bit more than you would if you're not smoking, based upon the way the formulas have been developed in this initial go-round. But the bottom line is that you're going to basically pay your fair share and no more than this. Okay, so now when you look at insuring anything, including healthcare, it's kind of the 80-20 rule. And I say in healthcare, it's like the 70-30 rule. So, you know, 70% of us are relatively healthy. A small percentage of us don't even interact with the healthcare system and don't spend anything. But those 70% of us that are healthy are paying premiums to fund the 30% of us that need access to health care coverage. And so, and 4 to 5% of the population is consuming, you know, over 25%, some estimates are up to 40% of the total cost of healthcare are being borne to cover the needs of that very small portion of our population. And so, and then you know, that 30% is of the sick population is only able to be covered if we have the premiums coming in from the healthy population. And so when we go transition from what we call medical underwriting, meaning that basically we're medically underwriting on your individual status, and you're in your 20s, and we say you're healthy, and you basically, we can write you a policy for $120 per member per month, okay? And then you go into community rating, and you're in a pool with everybody else, and you take the $100 premium average with the $500 premium for the first one's 50, and you blend that together, you're going to see an increase from 100, 150, probably. There's some age adjustment, but your premium's likely to go up by maybe even 100% or more, because you're funding a portion of the cost of care for everyone else, including some attributed to the older population. Now, a lot of young people tell me, well, that's not fair. I'm healthy. I don't, you know, I shouldn't have to bear that cost. And I say, well, if the system is operating for the long term, you're eventually going to get old, and somebody else is going to subsidize you. And so there is some equity in the way this is established. And and I said, the best minds in the industry were behind putting a lot of this together. And it really was very thoughtful. Some of it wasn't practical because the industry didn't operate in some of these ways that this came about. But what we have today are these market exchanges that will give you guaranteed access. If you are a documented citizen and you play by the rules and you're eligible for subsidies, you're going to get your subsidies and you're going to get access to health care. This is the first time we've had this in this country, quite frankly. And we've got 20 million more people that are covered now than we had before. There's still almost 30 million that aren't covered, but you know, we're kind of rolling down this pathway. And the market exchanges were a way of avoiding kind of a single payer system and fostering competition and also respecting states' rights in a lot of this. And so and the market exchanges were actually, you might not realize this, as much as the Republicans are decrying these exchanges, they were promulgated by Republicans. And Mitt Romney was one of the key Republicans that implemented this in Massachusetts. And this was a Republican idea. And it's a good idea. It needs, you know, there was failure in the initial implementation, and there's market stability that has to happen. But the basic framework of the exchanges is pretty sound. And so when you step back and look at where we are, 10 essential health benefits, all of us have access. We don't like what we're paying for, but quite frankly, it could be a lot worse. And on average, we might be paying 30% of the cost of coverage for our care. And we're just going to have to, as a society, because of the problems that we've created by breeding all this unhealthy behavior in our society that's created this pandemic of cost. This is like fighting the war on health and the healthcare crisis, brought about by ourselves. And so we're paying, you know, the freight for the next, you know, handful of years until we can get through this cycle and we can change the trajectory of healthcare. The ultimate thing that's going to happen, I think, in the country is, as far as competition, many experts and myself included believe that each market is going to basically vertically integrate into a healthcare ecosystem. And if you think about it, every other industry, and compare where we are in healthcare to those other industries, and you think about, this is probably the most knowledge-intensive industry of any industries. It has to do with managing our health status, monitoring all of our body systems and all that sort of thing in a holistic way. We're going from an era of physician-directed solo practitioner healthcare into an ecosystem of healthcare. And I use the airline analogy in this context. So if you take, for example, would you feel comfortable hopping in a plane to fly across the country with a pilot that's a solo pilot that's not connected to air traffic control towers and surveillance systems and feel safe that you can get from point A to point B across the country safely? The answer to that is no, absolutely not. So it's the same thing in healthcare. You need to have a system, a technology platform, population health technology platform that has all the data about your health and what you're doing, or gaps in care, or your non-compliance issues, all of those things, so that basically the people, whether they're your caregivers or your physicians or other people, can actually help you improve your health status, you know, and get compliant with medications or whatever it might be. And the only way to do that is to basically be in this ecosystem that has all of this information and with sophisticated decision support that's guiding that care. And I will tell you, I mean, I've worked in this industry for 30 years, and I wouldn't go to a solo practitioner that isn't connected to an ecosystem of sophisticated healthcare delivery. If you do, you're taking your life in the hands to a greater extent than is necessary. And so you really need to basically look at how the industry is evolving, and the way that we're going to basically drive efficiency is to have competition in markets with vertically integrated systems that are going to be competing for you, for your service, for your enrollment on the basis of cost, quality, access, and service levels. And if you take, for example, the U.S. News and World Report of the top health plans in this country, from a quality and a rating perspective, they're virtually all integrated delivery systems. And so we're basically in the process, if you will, of consolidating the industry. I don't see the day in the not too distant future, basically individual physicians, or unless you're in a boutique like cosmetic surgery or something, but for mainline physicians or mainline hospitals, the era of a full-service independent community hospital, it's just not scalable. It can't survive the test of time. And it would be too costly for us to be able to try to sustain that. And you can't, it just can't be done. So then you look at the impact of technology on our industry. When I started in healthcare 30 years ago, over 80% of everything we did was done on an inpatient basis. Members of the patients came into the hospital into a bed, okay? 20% of us were in there for exploratory surgery. There was no advanced imaging. I witnessed in my lifetime, in my 40 years, the creation of the PC, digital imaging, telecommunication, and that all has come about in the last 30 to 40 years. And so now that we have that, virtually all of those people that came in for exploratory surgery now can be treated on an outpatient basis with imaging, advanced imaging, non-invasive advanced imaging. And I could take you through every area of healthcare delivery. Many of you, if you require hip replacement surgery, many advanced healthcare systems are doing this on a same day or an overnight basis. And it used to be weeks. Or liver resections, appendicitis, they're all brain surgery with gamma knife, they're all same-day services. So if you look at all of those things, we used to deliver babies 4 to 7 day lengths of stay in the hospital. Many times it was more than a week in the hospital. Those things are like you're in and out in a couple of days, and that's pretty much it. Or we did cataract surgeries. We would bring patients into the hospital, lock them into place, operate on their eye, and then they couldn't move. They weren't supposed to move for 3 days while their eye was self-recuperating. It's a 30-second procedure now. So you just go through all those, the statins and medication advances. You know, the rates of open heart procedures are down 30-40% in most markets. It's because those of us in the last, you know, half dozen years that are on a statin, we're not going to have clogging, you know, hardening of the arteries, because our arteries are open because of these statins. And so the advances across all of these areas of healthcare are so profound that basically we build a system of hospital care and physician care that basically is becoming antiquated. And it's going to take another decade or more to basically